All right, okay. Welcome everybody. Thanks, Julia, for the introduction. My name is Sasha Tsapin, and today I will guide you through the history of Mars exploration. And before we begin, let me check how you feel. If you feel real good, real great, just type 9. If you don't feel great, you feel really bad, type 1. If you're so-so, type 5, and we'll check the same thing in the end of our journey, okay? Let's go. This summer brought this coronavirus crisis, but I think if I'm not correct, Julie will correct me, that because of that, we had a lot of interesting lectures on this platform about space, science, life in space, and so on. And I gave a lecture, I believe it was 6-7 weeks ago, and we talked about life in space and how, what is life and how we are going to detect it and so forth. And we eventually came up with the short list of destinations in our solar system, Europa, Titan, Enceladus, and Mars. We decided that this is kind of the best places to go to search for life. And if Europa, Titan, and Enceladus, they have a lot of liquid water, but Mars doesn't have liquid water, and NASA's mantra is, you know, is follow the water when NASA talk about search for life. So why we're still going to Mars over and over again? I would appreciate if you share your thoughts about this in chat. And the question is, why we still going to Mars? And I give you 10, 15 seconds so you can answer this question and tell us why we're so persistent, even we have maybe better destinations where we maybe probability of finding life is better than on Mars. Okay. Well,
let me tell you some of the answers that we get here, Sasha, if you don't mind.
No, so, I don't. Yeah, I fortunately I don't see chat. Yeah. Okay. All right. Okay.
Yeah, I can give you some of the ideas.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So people mostly say that, first of all, it's close enough to us, that it also has gravity. I'm not really sure what type of gravity, Charlotte, you want to talk about here, because it was maybe habitable in past, because it has moons, because we hope to find some life on Mars, and because it has water, or because if we want to terraform it, it will be easier. Or maybe we are looking for fossils there. So these are some of the ideas, and people also say Venus is better.
Venus, of course, is better. I agree with you guys. Yeah, I also. But we did not, I mean, last time we decided, no, Venus is a too tough place to go because it's too hot and pressure is too high. It's just technologically, it's too difficult to go. And you see, I mean, this is Mars. It's not in scale. This is Mars. This is Europa. And you can see this water ocean underneath of ice shell. The same thing in Enceladus. And also, it's really interesting feature on Enceladus, these water jets from the South Pole. And we tested, we flew through these jets and analyzed a little bit of the composition of this salty water. And this is Titan, and last time we talked about that oil company, they have to provide us means to go there because in return, they can put some kind of pipe and bring carbon hydrates from Titan to Earth, because Titan is filled with ethane and methane and so on. Yeah. And so here, what happened? Why I cannot move? Yeah. Okay. So why Mars anyway? Why we don't go to other places? And your answer is pretty much the same as my answer before, right? Mars is very close. I mean, it's 6-9 months to go. If we go to Europa, or Enceladus, it's 3-6 years. And also on Europa, we will have this problem as very intense radiation, which will... we have to develop, and we have some development in this area, all our instruments and computers and everything that can survive this harsh environment, but it's not easy. And Martian environment are much milder in comparison with Venus, as we talk about, and or Europa or Enceladus, okay? And Julia, do you have any kind of magic tip to me why it doesn't go every time? Because for some reason I cannot change slides, and I don't know really why. Yeah. Okay. Maybe when I remove chat, it will be better. Yeah. So some. If you look at the sky, I mean, you'll see this, it's not red, it's kind of a little bit maybe orange speck, and that's what Mars is, yeah, and people see, saw Mars, I mean, from first time they kind of look up, yeah, and this is our perception, history of our perception of Mars, and this is Mars as got to war. Right, because Mars is red and so it's kind of bloody. So that's why ancient people decided that it should be god of war. So polar caps were discovered in the 17th century. Then this fellow started, published a paper talking about, he didn't have any proof, but it was just kind of his thought that Mars maybe have seas and land and maybe even life forms. Then the whole thing really took off when Schiaparelli, Italian astronomer, published his observation and said about Martian canali. Canali is in Italian, and when it was translated, it became canals, and it implies that it's maybe this structure, maybe they, these structures, maybe they have artificial origin. So everybody was very excited about that. And then Lowell published his book on Mars, and then later on in 5-6 years, Mars and its canals in 06. And he proposed that it was work of long gone civilization. Well, writers, they did not stay idle during that time. So Herbert Wells wrote this, The War of the Worlds, how Martians came to conquer Earth, because Mars became, I mean, really dry. And they decided to get away and colonize Earth. And then wonderful book, The Martian Chronicles by Ray Bradbury. And I really strongly recommend you to read this. Actually, not only this book, but I mean, anything you can find that was written by Ray Bradbury. He was wonderful writer. He died just a few years ago. So this is a map that was presented by Schiaparelli, and it's, I mean, you see it's a lot of channels, canals, whatever you call it, and he called it canali. this is from Lowell's work, and he thought that he saw some changes with seasons in this Martian, on Martian surface, and he decided that maybe as we have season changing on Earth, when in the spring we have greenery and trees are covered with leaves, that's the same thing on Mars, and then in the fall and in the winter leaves come down and everything is different. All right. Where did all these channels go? Why we don't see them anymore? I would really like you to take a cut and think about this and write in chat what you think. Where these channels go? Why we don't see, and nobody nowadays talking about these channels on Mars? Okay, once again, it's 20-30 seconds, and Julie will report to me. Right, Julie, thank you, about what kind of idea our listeners, viewers have about this topic.
So people say froze turned into ice. Dust covered them. They sunk underground. They were blown away. Erosion. Maybe we sent rovers and we saw mountains. Got broke by the solar radiation. Erosion. Freezing dust. Illusion.
Well,
so you many different suggestions here.
Okay, erosion sounds pretty good, but I mean, it did not, it probably cannot be eroded in so short time, like 100 years or something here. I think the main reason why we don't see channels anymore, because we have better equipment now. Our telescopes can see better, and we send spacecraft to Mars, and we did imaging from very short distance, and we don't see it. And that's very common thing. When you have blurred vision, you can imagine something, and then you're trapped into this. That's, I think, the main reason why. Some of them, I mean, we'll talk about erosion later on when we see pictures of some formation on the Martian surface. Let's kind of compare Earth and Mars, and this is pretty much on the same scale. And in this table, you see that Mars is twice, the diameter of Mars is two times smaller than diameter of Earth. And what more important probably is that gravitational acceleration, which we know as G, it's 975 here and only 371 on Mars. So G is almost three times smaller on Mars than here. So if that's really good, I can give this idea to companies that advertise magic bullets to lose weight. So if you go to Mars, I mean, you can lose two-thirds of your weight kind of right away, and that would be money-back guarantee thing, because they can stand by this. Yeah, if you, as I weigh like around 200 pounds, if I go to Mars, it's just 70 pounds and so, right? Just because of this flight, I will lose 130 pounds and no question, all right? Also, it's interesting that day on Earth is 24 hours and pretty much the same, just a little bit 40 minutes longer on Mars. Obviously, we have different longevity for the year, and also the atmospheric pressure 100 times, a little bit more than 100 times less on Mars than here on Earth. And there is a big difference in the atmospheric composition and last lecture week ago kind of touched on this. Here on Earth, we have oxygen and nitrogen. On Mars, it's mostly carbon dioxide and argon. Just very small traces, some other gases. So that how, I mean, relative to sun, we go sometimes, the closest can be 50 million kilometers, or in another kind of time when we Earth again closes, it's 100 million kilometers. And this video will kind of show us how the whole dynamic, how it works. You see, this is the, at that point where, when Earth was here, it was closest to Mars. Then in 1 year, after 1 year, I mean, Mars is really far away, yeah? So then goes one more year and a little bit more, and when Earth will be here, they will be in proximity, yeah, as well. So basically, that's why we send our space probes to Mars every 2 years. So when we're very close, I mean, relatively speaking, between the distance is minimal between Earth and Mars. And that's how we can go to Mars. We launch our rocket and it goes to Mars. And if we want to go from Mars to Earth, this is kind of this, that's the trajectory which we can follow. How we can explore Mars? And once again, I give you 10, 15, maybe 20 seconds, and I'll be waiting for your suggestion of what kind of methods we can use to explore Mars. Just free your imagination and shoot your suggestion. And Julia, I'll be waiting for your translation.
So people suggest to send the probes, to send humans, to send spaceships, robots, send AI, artificial intelligence, to explore the hostile terrain, send robots covered in a plastic coating so the dust doesn't erode them, invent special spacesuits, more robots and humans can study the specimens, send animals, send satellites to make photos, send hovercrafts, like
helicopters, something.
Helicopters, yes, probably. Make dustproof solar panels, humans. Bring potatoes.
Well, yeah, it's from this movie, Martian or Mars or whatever, yeah, right.
Humanoid robots try milking the planet for resources. Use robots to make the planetary base.
Time is up. Yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm. So,
Mike.
Nobody said about telescopes. That's kind of amazed me. I mean, we have telescopes. We can look at Mars without going into all this multi-million or billion projects sending robots to Mars or even a human being, right? And we can put them in really nice places like Hawaii or Atacama Desert or Australia, where terrestrial atmosphere will not interfere too much with our observation. So next thing is, of course, yeah, everybody on the same page about this. We need robotic missions, right? And then it's manned missions like Apollo program. However, it hasn't been done yet. And let's kind of think about this, that manned mission probably at least 100 or maybe even 1,000 times more expensive. And we don't have technology right now yet for manned expedition to Mars. I really admired Elon Musk and what he has done for space exploration, and I'm pretty sure we all watched recently this flawless launch and docking Crew Dragon to International Space Station. But I think he is too optimistic that flight to Mars, I mean manned flight to Mars, will happen in just 2024, 2025. I mean, he says something like this, yeah. I would be glad if I am wrong, but we'll see. It's just 5 years to go, and we'll see what happened. Will he be able to put men not on Martian surface, but at least kind of fly to Mars, fly by, make several orbits, and then come back safely. And this is key word, safely back to Earth, right? And this is my favorite slide, because it's like a Christmas tree. I mean, it's on this slide, you see, not all actually, I mean, it's all spacecrafts that were sent to Mars. I mean, they didn't find a place to put all spacecrafts that were sent to Mars on this picture. But you can see this, a lot of Soviet Union, this different flags, the American flag, Soviet Union, then ESA, which is, here we go, ESA, it's European Space Agency, then it's Japan, and somewhere India, Indian flag, I guess, and China, I don't see Chinese flag, but China tried to, China put, lander on Phobos ground mission that was launched in 2011, but it did not make beyond Earth orbit. So you can see, I mean, a lot of just enormous, and we see on the next slide how many missions we already sent to Mars. And see, you can see some of landers. It's not all landers that landed safely and worked on Martian surface, but you can see it's not also kind of a lot. I mean, given the distance and how difficult I think to fly to Mars. I mean, a lot of scientists think that 3.5 billion years ago, Mars was wet and had oceans and seas and rivers and a lot of water, and probably, or not probably, and maybe it was life on Mars at the time. But right now it's very dry, and it's difficult to think that we can find life at least on the surface of Mars. So what do you think? How you would search for this extinct life that used to be on Mars, and we have to go now? What is kind of the main thing? What you would do? What kind of equipment you put on a spacecraft to go to Mars and search for life that used to be? And once again, it's chat time and 15, 20 seconds, and we'll go. And we'll continue after that. And Julia?
So how do we search for life? Test soil, paleontologists, fossils, strip mine, dig for fossils, dig or blow up.
Yeah, I like that. Yeah, blow up. Yeah, right.
Yeah. infrared cameras to test for trapped heat.
For trapped what?
I'm trapped sorry. Heat. Okay. Probably looking for life that generates some heat, I'm not really sure. Look for traces of water, microscope, or some sort of sensor, and a sort of spade. Drill, shovel, pickaxe for fossil. Underground cameras.
Okay, all right, okay. Well, I mean, everybody, I think it's consensus is that we have to dig down, yeah, because maybe life on the surface was destroyed by irradiation and everything, but maybe if we go, I mean, deep down, we can find something. It's interesting idea to use explosion, but we have to think this, the whole concept through about explosion. Maybe we just drop something really heavy and it will open some layers underneath of Martian surface, yeah. Well, I mean, I have to tell you that you said, and scientists listened to you, and now they're sending in 6-8 weeks probe there to Mars that will have drill that can drill up to 2 meter deep. I mean, 2 meter deep is, of course, it's not a lot, but it's much better than nothing. Yeah, I think you would agree with me about that. How many missions you think we already sent to Mars? And take a guess, and I give you like 10 seconds so we can put some numbers in chat. Maybe it's 10 missions, maybe it's 20, maybe it's 50, maybe it's 100, or maybe even 1,000. It's kind of try to find out what it is, all right?
Oh, okay. People get anything from 3 to 1,000. So it's a wild, many wild guesses there.
Yeah. And the right answer is we sent by now 56 missions. Only 26 have been successful. why so many missions failed? I mean, it looks like it's not really big deal. It's not difficult to send a rocket to Mars. I mean, we now send rockets and satellites around Earth. I mean, just maybe every month or something like this. Yeah. So once again, go to chat and share your thoughts. Why so many missions were not successful? And at the time, I will. That's how I split this 56 missions in years. Yeah, so in the beginning, it was like 25% of success. Then it up to 33, then 57, because it's 7 launches and only 4 launches were successful. But nowadays we have 75%, and it's a pretty big number, and some of them still working on the Martian surface, right? Yeah, so what we got, Julia, what people
So we think? Have technical errors, missed Mars orbit, didn't have, had old technology, just a second, let me, problems of communications, first communication, difficult landing, Martian dust, explosions, because it was going so fast.
Yeah, I think it's, I would agree.
Blew up before landing, wind, radiation, Martian dust, no right equipment. Yeah, at Mars atmosphere is very thin. It's hard to land, crashing, technical difficulties, mountains, missed the planet altogether. Heat, yeah. Bad landing abilities, and so on, dust storms, right?
Yeah, okay, thanks, Julie. Yeah, no,
oh, I think wrong code also, wrong software.
Well, that's happened definitely, yeah, we know about that, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And we sent several missions, they were kind of just fly by, they kind of flew, and especially this in red, yeah, first successful flyby. It was in 65 by American Mariner 4, and I will show you pictures, at least one picture that was taken by Mariner 4. Rovers, what is rovers? Well, rovers, basically it's cars, and in this case it's not four-wheel drive, it's six-wheel or eight-wheel drive things that go, usually it's six, that roaming on Martian surface, and it's really fun to design, I guess, that type of car. And what do you think? I mean, how many parts are in space probe? What parts can you build your space probe or rover from Lego. I think it depends on what kind of Lego, what kind of store or manufacturer we are going to use, and will this Lego Martian probe do things you want to do with this spacecraft. And let me share you this story of this ill-fated Russian Phobos Grunt mission. It was delayed several times, and you, if you remember, I said before that is, if you miss your window of opportunity, you have to wait for 2 more years. So I think it was pushed back like 4 or 6 years, this mission. And in the last incarnation, Chinese lander was added, and it turned out the design was not right, not for the lander. Lander was okay, but the when they tried to assimilate this lander into already built spacecraft, they got a problem. Some robotic arm could not be open. So it's a difficult task, but then if we put rover on surface, we can visit, quite a few destinations, right? So this is a picture of several Martian rovers. And do you know their names, and do you know what they are? I once again go to chat, and I will, because we're running out of time a little bit, I will give it just 5-7 seconds, and then we go. So first rover NASA sent to Mars, it was Sojourner, then it was Spirit and Opportunity, then that kind of work almost at the same time, then Curiosity, and in 6 weeks, Perseverance will be heading to the red planet as well. It will be, it should be launched if everything is going okay on July 17, next, as I said, next month, in the middle of next month. Okay, and I really like this movie about how first rover, the Mars Pathfinder, this is animation, it's not a real movie, how it landed. So it was, in my view, very interesting, very clever, and very cheap design. They, instead of doing rockets for soft landing, they just covered spacecraft, this lander that had a rover inside. They covered with these bags, and you see, it just kind of, it's bounced up and down, and eventually it stopped. And then we'll see, boom. Yeah, I really like this, how it goes, because it goes really slow, because as we talked before, the G is 3 times less on Martian surface than on the surface of Earth. And then eventually it will stop anyway. Bags will be deflated, they were deflated. And it's, just wait for a second. Everything boom, and it will then it has sensor, it kind of turn on right side, and then it's open, and here we go. All right, so the whole, it's miracle happened. And unfortunately, this technology was not used later on, because later on our rovers became larger and heavier, and we couldn't find the right bags to use this technology. So let's kind of follow what happens with this guy later on. Yeah, next in the morning, mast went up, and then camera goes up, kind of looking in all directions, trying to find who is speeding and whom I have to give ticket. They didn't find anybody. And now it started, rover moved down and started investigation was going on Mars. And it's a really small thing. It's like, this is 60 by 40 by 30 centimeters. It's just tiny by today's standard. Now it goes and probably will boom. Yeah. All right. So what kind of pictures, as I said, I mean, we started first probe to Mars was sent in 1960, just 3 years after first Sputnik, yeah? And early pictures, it was a picture taken by Mariner 4. And it was really disappointing because picture was okay, but when you look at this picture, it looks like moon. So any kind of hope that Mars will harbor life, they kind of went down really after that. But people keep forgetting about this and they continue to search for life and think how they search for life on Martian surface here. And this picture taken by Viking, what it's 12, 15 years later, and you see this, it looks like face, right? Like human face. And this is the same picture. And here, a picture taken much later by Martian orbiter. And the reason we don't see this, because this picture was enhanced and this picture is a real picture. And you see that, still see maybe here, you can imagine that this is human face sort of, and just keep in mind that this is probably 100 kilometers or something like this. So it's really cyclopic structure. Why these pictures are not, were not very good? Once again, I mean, do you have any idea about that? And you already said that the equipment, the technology was not as good as we have it now, and everybody, probably almost everybody has now a smartphone, and smartphone is like 100 or even 1,000 times more capable than computers that we used in 60s and 70s when we flew to Mars. And this is Viking, we talk about Viking program. this is one of the Viking lander. It was shot before it was launched. And Viking mission consisted of two pretty much identical spacecraft, Viking 1 and Viking 2. And each of them had orbiter that should take pictures of Martian surface to find place where to land. And then it was a lander on each on each spacecraft that should land and study Martian surface. And when mission was designed and executed, everybody thought, not everybody, but quite a few people thought that we'll be able to find life on Mars, and they designed really sophisticated experiments, and technology was just fantastic. And from technological point of view, it was a great success. And they invited even Ray Bradbury to the control room so he can see how in real life data of this life detection experiments flow into this room. But unfortunately, results were disappointing. They did not find they didn't find any life. However, few people, very few, but still they think that Viking were able to find biosignature, but as I said, I mean, it's just a few people left that still think this. And this is picture of, and just I show you to so you can appreciate how difficult, how complicated this package for life detection was. So in all, So it was nice technology, but we did not know much about biology at the time. We did not know much about life in extreme environment. And one of the things that come to my mind is that if you, as I said here, if you feed a person who was on hunger strike for 30 days, if you give him really good barbecue and everything, there is a possibility that this person will die. The same thing with bacteria we brought on with Viking, just really good nutrition to this, to bacteria that we expected there, but they, if they were there, probably they were not anyway. They would be starving and we would kill them if they were there. And also Viking mission discovered, Viking mission did not discover, but it took 20 years after that to realize that what really happened was that Viking was not able to detect any organic, because it was Martian soil had very strong oxidant perchlorate. And is it good or bad news for Mars research, the presence of perchlorate? It's kind of mixed bag. It's good for something and bad for other things. So some microbes, it turned out they can use perchlorate to breathe. So we breathe oxygen, and these bugs, they can breathe and use perchlorate as a terminal electron acceptor to generate energy. It's for human exploration, we can use perchlorate to get power and also oxygen, but at the same time, it's kind of toxic for human beings. So as I said, it's a mixed bag, but that's what it is. I mean, we have perchlorate on Martian soil, and Phoenix mission that was in 2008, I believe, they provided really strong and direct evidence that there is a perchlorate in Martian soil. And when it happened, it turned out that asparagus, when you add just a little bit, tiny amount of perchlorate, grows better than without. So that's from, I believe it's from onion. If you know what kind of magazine is onions, yeah, that's what it is. But at the same time, Viking provided us with precise measurements of the composition of the Martian atmosphere. Why it's important, how we can use this information in our search for life. Once again, you can go to chat and try to figure out what happened, why we need to know that. I will continue because, as I said, time goes by, yeah? When you share your thoughts about that, we'll talk about samples from Mars. And the question is, it would be nice to have some kind of ferry that will bring sample from Mars, and we don't have to fly rockets and think how to land on Mars and then come back with this sample and so on. And maybe we have these Martian samples over there. And the answer is yes, we do have. And actually we have not one, we have 266 meteorites that came from Mars. And why we know that? Because when we analyze the composition of gases in all meteorites, we found that in some of them, and specifically in 266, it matches exactly the composition of Martian atmosphere. And that was measured by Viking. That was absolutely nice and wonderful results that brought us to understand that some meteorites we can find on Earth came from Mars. But what is the problem with Martian samples, with Martian meteorites, if we decide to use them as a kind of samples to trace Martian life once again. And this is, yeah, I'll give you 15 seconds, okay, to find out what could be the problem with Martian meteorites.
So,
Zulia?
So let's wait for people. So what is the problem with the Martian meteorites if we want to explore Mars? People say they're probably very ancient, so they don't reflect what's going on there right now.
That's true.
They're probably not from the depths of the planet. They come from the surface.
Well, from some depth, but yeah, basically it's closer to the surface than to the center of the Mars. That's correct, yeah.
How can we make sure that they're actually from Mars?
We just talk about this because we do know, I mean, this is no question. We do know that composition of gases in these meteorites matches exactly like 100% with the composition of Martian atmosphere. Yeah.
So they say they may be polluted and contaminated by the Earth's atmosphere.
Bingo. Yeah, that's the whole thing. Yeah. I mean, everything you said before, that's true, but I mean, at the same time, because sometimes we do know, sometimes we don't know for how long it was, it can be contaminated with terrestrial life. Okay. And here, this is the very famous paper published in Science in 1996. Where authors, they said that analyzing this meteorite LH84001, they presented five indirect evidences that this meteorite carried biomarkers from extinct life on Mars. Well, I mean, next 5-10 years, all of these five indirect evidences were, and this is actual picture, electron microscopic picture from inside of this meteorite. And you can see it looks like, I don't know, microbes or worm or something. The only problem is that it's very tiny. It's probably volume-wise 100 times smaller than any microbe on Earth. And in five, as I said, 5-10 years, all of these five indirect evidences were kind of taken down. But general public was so excited about the once again reignited interest to study Mars, to search for life on Mars, that NASA created program astrobiology, created Astrobiology Institute, and it's still going strong even until now. And that's one of the rover, I believe it's Opportunity, they discovered, they took this picture of spherules, and it looks like, because in false color, it looks like blueberries, and that's what scientists call. And when you go to Mars and you see this round, really nice things, I mean, you think it's maybe it has something to do with life. And this is artistic presentation, what you can maybe, you go to Mars and you see this some kind of hybrid between strawberry and acorn, and what do you think? I mean, is it life or not? Okay,
take a guess,
And so, once again, I mean, we ended where we started, so we still don't know the answer to this question. Are we alone in the universe? And quest is going on, and now it's your time for ask some questions, okay? And I will try to turn chat on for myself, yeah, but I still will rely on Julia's help. Thank you.
So, okay, so some time for your questions. We have like 5 minutes. Oh, wow. So, People say, what would happen to someone if they were outside of the universe? Do you want to ask about universe or galaxy here, Alex? So, the universe. Is it possible for us to get outside of the universe, Sasha?
It's a really good question, yeah. And I don't know answer to this question yet. I think maybe in the future when the theory of Strun and some other esoteric...
String theory.
Uh-huh. Some other esoteric theories kind of bring us technology that we can be teletransported in the nick of time somewhere, then maybe we can answer this question. What is type one civilization? I don't know.
First of all, there was another question. Have you worked with the Martian probes yourself? Have you designed any of the Martian probes yourself or worked with someone who worked on the Martian probes?
The answer is yes and no. Yes, in the sense that I submitted a couple proposals, what kind of instruments I think would be really nice to send to Mars, but eventually these instruments, they didn't make a cut. And one of the instruments, it was just few kilograms, scanner, X-ray tomograph scanner, because the idea what I had at the time was that if you go to desert or in many cases you can find rocks, pebbles, and from outside it's nothing interesting, but if you cut you can see, especially if it's kind of sandstone type of thing, you can see that under the surface of this stone, like 2, 3, 5 maybe millimeters deep, you'll see the layer of algae. They live there, and the reason they live there, why they try to go into the rock, because this way they are protected from harsh radiation from sun in desert, from UV and so on. And so the idea was that we can if we decided to bring some rocks from Mars to Earth, it would be nice to put them inside the scanner, this tomograph. And if there is no kind of interesting structure inside, probably it's very boring sample. We better try to find something that has a structure inside. But as I said, it did not make a cut, and there are very nice instruments on all these rovers, and Opportunity and Spirit and Curiosity, and now this Perseverance, and I'm pretty sure. But yeah, I didn't make a cut. It's sad, but you don't win every time.
So do you think humans will go to Mars in our lifetime and their lifetime?
Yeah,
is like the next century.
Eventually people like Musk or somebody else, I mean, will design and make it happen. Yeah, it will take, in my view, at least 10, 15, maybe 20 times, and hopefully we'll live together in peace and harmony, and we'll be able to do this. Yeah, I mean, I'm not sure that we'll find, as I said in the beginning, it's cost thousand times more to send human and bring back safely to Mars. But at the same time, yeah, some people talk about this, doing terraforming to change Martian atmosphere. So it takes a lot of time, definitely, yeah, and a lot of
Do you think humans will die in the process of going to Mars?
Some of them. Not all. Yeah.
So this is actually the end of our class. So everyone, hold on to your questions for our next lecture, right? One more question probably that we can answer. Can we import greenhouse gases from Earth to Mars? How can we warm up Mars? This is
we don't have to bring our waste to Mars. I mean, definitely we don't have to bring CO2, carbon dioxide to Mars, because there are a lot of carbon dioxide in Martian polar camps. The only question, not the only question, but one of the question is how to make it to melt it and put into atmosphere, and at the same time to be sure that it doesn't go away, right? Because eventually, I mean, some point in Martian life, probably it had some kind of atmosphere, not as thin as it has now. But yeah, I mean, that's everybody who is thinking about terraforming Mars, that's kind of the idea, to use this CO2 caps to make kind of surface of Mars warmer, and maybe it will bring some water if it is on the surface, to the surface. Thank you.
Okay, well, thank you so much. And thank you everyone who came to this webinar and asked their questions, and come back again next Friday. Remember, we have another webinar with Dr. Pavlov at noon, and invite your friends as well, right? So this webinar was on the history of Mars exploration. Next webinar will be on what we plan to do with Mars in the 21st century. So some of your questions will be great for the next webinar. Hold on to them, right?
Yeah, it's really exciting, yeah.
Okay, well, Sasha, thank you so much. You see, we had lots and lots of participants. We had over 70 participants, 73 actually. Now people are leaving, of course, right now. But yes, thank you so much.
Okay.
That was a great webinar. I think everyone enjoyed it, right? Thank you.